What's up, everyone? My name's Robbie. This is Robbie Amanila, and today we're talking about the best yielding ETFs from Vanguard. So I took a look at every Vanguard ETF, and I found multiple ETFs that have yields of at least 2% or higher. Now, from there, I took all the different ETFs that I found, and I took a look at the different risk-adjusted returns that they've had in the past. I also took a look at their category ranking to see where they rank within their category, what percentile rank they are. And the last thing I did was consider the sector of the ETF or the industry of the ETF. So I came up with three pretty good yielding Vanguard ETFs that I think you're going to want to take a look at. So let's go ahead and run the intro and take a look at these different ETFs. Okay, so here we are, the three best yielding Vanguard ETFs for 2021. Now remember that I said Vanguard yielding ETFs. So these are my best or my favorite three ETFs from Vanguard. I don't think these are necessarily the best ETFs out of all fund companies. I just think these are the best for Vanguard. So if you want to see my favorite of, like, let's say all of ETFs with decent yields, take a look at this video here. These are my three favorite out of multiple different companies' ETFs. So this one is just for Vanguard. Anyway, I'll also link that video in the description below if you want to watch it at the end of this, so take a look at that. So here we go. By the way, the last thing I want to say before we begin, hit the like button. I'd really appreciate that. So if you want to support my channel, hit the like button. Thanks. So let's go ahead and get into this. So the first one we have here is called Vanguard High Dividend Yield Index Fund ETF. VYM is a ticker symbol. And so here's a product summary of VYM. So VYM seeks to track the performance of the FTSE High Dividend Yield Index, measures the investment return of common stocks of companies characterized by high dividend yields. So this is a replication, full replication approach. So these Vanguard ETFs, they are oftentimes, or actually I think all of them are, just tracking an index. They are not actively managed ETFs. Vanguard is not going out and trying to pick specific stocks. They're trying to replicate an index of, in this situation, the FTSE High Dividend Yield Index. So that's what you, something that you probably should know. And if you don't understand what that means, that's not a big deal, but just know that that's what this is doing. And then we're gonna go to the expense ratios and things like that. So every Vanguard ETF is gonna be pretty low expense ratio, actually very low expense ratio. So 0.06%, also known as 6 basis points, very low, dirt cheap, no problems here. So the 5-year category rank for this one is the 49th percent. So this one actually is not the best performing in the category, but for Vanguard, it's actually one of the ones that I thought was the best. So, and one of the reasons that I say the best is because I took also into consideration the risk that the different ETFs took. And then also, I didn't include any other kind of sector ETFs, like in a weird sector or like the real estate sector or something like that. So I wanted to really go with more of a broad sector, broad market-based ETFs in this one. So the growth of $10,000 in over 5 years would have grown to $16,457, and it yields 3.19%. So the yield's not too bad. The growth isn't great. So again, if you watch my favorite ETFs video, you'll see that there are at least one or two that did probably a lot better than this one in the 5-year growth, but also yielded a similar amount. And so actually, I believe in that video, it was about 19,000 was the growth of over 5 years for the one ETF that I like the most with a similar yield, essentially. So VYM's top 10 holdings, you're gonna get a lot of companies you've heard of. You got Johnson & Johnson, so let's say fast moving consumer goods, banking, pharmaceutical stuff, we got banking again, tech, communications, wide variety of large companies, okay? Of course, this is a dividend yielding ETF, so you're gonna get a lot of these older companies, bigger companies, blue chip companies that pay dividends and maybe don't have much growth potential, but you get decent yields. VYM's growth of 10,000 was 16, that grew to 16,457 over a 5-year period. Now remember that the S&P 500 did way better. It grew to 21,148 over the same period. So it definitely is not going to give you great price outperformance probably over a long-term period of time of the S&P 500. Now, there are times where this may do decent. We're just not in one of those times right now. We're in really like a high growth stock time period where growth stocks are doing a lot better. And even in, like in the S&P 500, like tech companies are really winning the game, and a lot of tech companies don't pay dividends. So you're not gonna get yield from those companies that have done a really good job as of late. But times always change and market is cyclical. There are ebbs and flows. I'm telling you, at some point in time in the future, things like this will probably outperform, and then they won't again, and then they will, and then they won't. But right now, they're not doing as well when looking back over the past few years. So VYM's returns over the past 5 years, so you got a 10.48% return annualized. I mean, that's actually a really good return in my opinion. I would be happy with that. The only difference is, when you look at that and you say, well, the S&P 500 grew 16.16% over the same time period, that's where you kind of get this disconnect when you're like, well, okay, comparatively, maybe I don't love the fact that it only grew 10%, but if you're really not looking for as much like return or risk, or you don't care about capital appreciation as much and you really care more about yield, then this is gonna be better for you probably. So, over the 10-year, 11.27%. Again, I mean, that's a great return. But when you look at the S&P 500, of course, it outperformed this ETF. So, okay, let's go to the next one and take a look at risk. So this is a 4-star fund based on Morningstar's category rankings. So the risk return, if you've watched my videos, you know I talk about this a lot. And by the way, if you haven't watched my videos, this is one of the things that I think are most important on all of the things I go over are these slides about risk. So pay attention to these. So on the Morningstar risk, you have the risk versus the category. So the category that this ETF falls under. So it's below average for the risk. So that's good as long as the return is also average or above average or high. And it is. So that's what you want to see. I would love to see having a lower risk but a higher return, but this is not going to get that one, at least this specific one. And a few of these Vanguard ETFs aren't quite designed to, or not designed, but they haven't performed as well. So that's one of the reasons you're not going to see that in some of these. But for the volatility measures, I usually look at beta, I look at alpha, and I look at standard deviation. So the alpha underperformance, beta, actually not too bad. So this is a lower beta ETF. So a little bit less risk versus the market. And then standard deviation's not too bad at 17.79%. So on a risk basis, not too bad of a fund. But then when we do take a look at the capture ratios, which again, if you haven't seen my videos yet, I always talk about these capture ratios. So this is the 3-year and this is the 5-year capture ratios. And what a capture ratio is it's something from Morningstar. Morningstar takes into consideration how much of an upside ETF will capture and how much of the downside an ETF will capture in times of, let's say, when ETFs or the market's going up, how much of the upside does it actually take and get a hold of, right? And then does it take all of the downside as well, or is it lose more than the market? So on this one, the upside was only 78. So it's not getting much of the upside over the past 3 years. And if you take a look at the past 5 years, 82, it's not getting that much of the upside. 100 being the upside of the market, let's say. So it's not quite getting the upside. And then on the downside, it's actually also getting the downside even a little bit more than the market. So it's not getting the upside on the market, but it's also getting more of the downside. Now, again, this is a time where these types of ETFs and stocks and yields haven't done so great. So, you know, in that situation, maybe this is gonna do better over time if these types of stocks tend to start doing better. So the index lost 26.73% from the peak to trough of the highest loss over the past 3 years here and 5 years here. So, and this lost 23.96%. So it lost less than the index. So at least at a time when the worst drop was, which was around, you know, the time where the illness struck. It was in March of 2020, and that was when these drawdown valleys happened. Okay, so you lost a little bit less than the overall market. So if that's what you're looking for, great. And now let's go to number two. So VTV, Vanguard Value Index Fund ETF shares. What's value? Well, there's growth and value. So value stocks sometimes are more out of favor companies. Sometimes they do pay some yields and stuff like that. So this seeks to track the performance of the CRSP US Large Cap Value Index. So that's what it does. It's taking that index and it's trying to replicate the index. So VTV's expense ratio is 0.04, even lower than the one we just spoke about. The five-year category rank is in the top 26% best, so not too bad. I like to see it around like the top 20% or better. So top 26%, not too bad. Growth 10,000 grew to 17,348, so more than our last ETF that we talked about. But the yield is also a bit lower at 2.58%. The top 10 holdings for this one, you're gonna see Johnson & Johnson actually in most of these. So Johnson & Johnson, you got Buffett with Berkshire Hathaway in there, which is interesting because Buffett doesn't pay a dividend, but it's in here anyway. So you got that, you got some banks, consumer discretionary, or consumer cyclical stocks, fast moving consumer goods, stuff like that. Some tech, so you got a lot of different things in here. And then you have the VTV returns. Again, it underperformed the S&P 500. 21,148 was the S&P 500's return. This returned 17,348 over the 5 year. VTV's returns, so a 10-year return of 10.82. Again, like I would be okay with these returns. You know, I would be okay with it, of course. I would have loved to get a higher return just investing in the S&P 500, but only certain people would invest in these different ETFs. You want yield, and you're okay with maybe taking a little bit back capital appreciation-wise so you can get some income. And that's usually what people that want these types of ETFs are doing. So VTV's risk, it's a 4-star fund as well with Morningstar, below average risk, above average returns versus the category, and that's good. So that's like what I like to see. Alpha, negative 3.65 underperformance. Beta, a little bit less than the market at 0.98. Not too bad, pretty good. Standard deviation, lower than the last ETF we looked at, so 15.29, so that's good too. So risk, the risk is a bit lower on the standard deviation. The capture ratios, so we're taking a look here at the upside and downside again. Upside, only 85% on the 3 year, and then 88% on the 5 year, and then on the downside, 108 and 106. So, and this one actually lost more peak to trough at that same time period than the last ETF we just talked about. So this lost a little bit more. The other one was about 23-ish%. This went down about 25%, a little bit less than the index did over that period of time. So again, upside, not getting as much of the upside. Now on the downside, it's getting the downside or a bit more than the market. So, you know, again, it's kind of the environment that these stocks have been, these particular types of ETFs are trading in right now, not as favorable to the companies that are in these ETFs. Next, we have number one. So we have the Vanguard Mega Cap Value Index Fund ETF shares, so MGV. MGV seeks to track the performance of the CRSP US Mega Cap Value Index. Again, replication strategy, trying to replicate the index. Mega Cap, they're giant companies, right? So they're gonna invest only in very large companies. And so the expense ratio on this one is 0.07%, just a tad bit more than the other two. The 25-year category ranking in the top 25% best. Growth of 10,000 was 17,427. And that's over 5 years. And then the distribution yield, 2.49%. This has the lowest yield, but it's got the highest growth over the 10-year period, I believe. So MGV's top 10 holdings, again, Johnson & Johnson, Berkshire Hathaway, right? So the same ones as before. JPMorgan Chase, Procter & Gamble. So these all kind of have a very similar portfolio with the top 10 holdings. A lot of these have been the same different holdings in all three of these portfolios. MGV's returns, again, you know, it underperformed. The blue line is MGV, underperformed the S&P 500. S&P 500 growing to 21,148. This growing to 17,427. And if you take a look at the category, which is the brown line, it did outperform the large value category. So that's good. Now, let's go over to the returns. You're going to see the five-year return, 11.75%. Again, I'm happy with a return like that over a five-year period. And a 10-year period, 10.88%. Again, you should be happy if you could ever get this type of return. You know, it's just the way that things are these days, like the market is going crazy. If you were to say this back in 2008 and 9, that you were to get a 10% rate of return over 10 years, you'd be ecstatic. So I'm just saying, like, you know, the time period makes it kind of look like, oh, you know, it's not that big of a deal, but I think it's a big deal. MGV's risk, Morningstar's ratings. So we have a four-star rating. So everyone that I've talked about today is a four-star Morningstar rated fund. It's below average risk, above average returns for the category. Nice stuff. And then for volatility, we've got a negative 3.19. For the alpha underperformance, beta 0.95, so not too bad on the beta, less volatile. And then standard deviation 14.88, so that's actually good. Standard deviation being the range in prices, so this has less of a range in price. And for capture ratios, on the 3-year we had an 84 upside, and then a 88 on the 5-year upside, and then a 105 on the downside for the 3-year, and a 104 on the downside for the 5-year. So again, upside is not quite getting 100% of the index. It's kind of limited, but it's getting 100% or more of the downside at 105 and 104. So, you know, it's not exactly getting what you want, but at least the maximum drawdown or peak to trough drawdown was 23.74%, less than the last ETF we just spoke about, which was around 25%. It's a little bit better there, but that's it. So those are the three top Vanguard ETFs that have decent yields, in my opinion. So like I said, when it comes to ETFs, these aren't necessarily my favorite ETFs in general for yield, but they're all decent. They're all okay. They're all something that you could maybe add as a small position in a portfolio. Could work out well. If you want to see my dividend yielding ETF video, my favorite three, again, take a look at the link below. Check that one out. And so that's it. Please hit this video if it helped you, and subscribe if you want to see more videos that are like this. And please watch another one of my videos on the end screen that's coming up right now.